what can I do when I can never, never, never go home again?
I've been made redundant.
Tom, no.
She's dead, I'm sorry.
Tom Howard, faced with the challenge of his life and prepared to gamble everything.
Listen to me, Jack, and listen carefully. I put everything I've got into this yard and I am going to make it work. And I want to do that with you. But I'm going to do it whatever way I have to. I am in partnership with you.
Determined against the wishes of his family.
What am I meant to say?
Well, I hope you'll say you'll back me. That we'll muck in as a family.
And if I don't?
Determined against the advice of his friends.
Now listen, Tom. If you put everything you've got into it, and you can, you leave yourself and your family totally exposed.
A story of love, of ambition, of success. Howard's Way, next Sunday at 7:45 on BBC One.
On BBC One now, Nick Ross and his team of experts and reporters present Watchdog.
Watchdog this week, gone fishing. How anglers could be catching rather more than they bargained for.
Welcome to Watchdog, where you tell us the stories, and if they're sad, funny, outrageous or unjust, we'll take them up on everyone's behalf. And we start with something that's familiar to everyone. It's this, an insect spray. Now, it's very good at killing insects, but it's not the sort of stuff you'd want sprayed over you. In fact, this one carefully says on the label, keep off skin, avoid breathing mist, wash hands after use. But as Nicholas Woolley now reports, chemicals not too dissimilar from this stuff are now being sprayed on people, and maybe you, a great deal of the time.
The part-time firemen of Old Wellin in Hertfordshire are trained to meet most kinds of emergency. But when the call came one sunny day last summer, it didn't sound to the officer in charge, Trevor Kendall, as if the report of a rick fire in a field near the neighbouring village of Kimpton was anything more than routine. Indeed, once he decided the best thing was to let the fire burn itself out, the crew had little to do but watch, with mild interest, an aircraft spraying the crops nearby.
As we were in shirt sleeve order, we all became very much aware of a sort of tingling sensation on our arms. And then our eyes started to smart. And then we all complained of dry mouths. The next thing we were aware was a second aircraft approaching from the east field, and globules were dropping from this particular aircraft whilst the other aircraft was still spraying and getting even closer. And so that was the time that I decided to make a hasty withdrawal. And we were then transported off to hospital.
At the same time, one of the inhabitants of the village, Mrs. Joanna Lee, was with her husband and young son walking the dog up the side of the field in which the stack was burning.
We carried on walking up the field when a light aircraft went overhead. It was very low, Richard thought it was great, so he stood there and jumped up and down and waved at it. In fact, we all did, like idiots. And then we saw that the chap was spraying, and we turned to come down the field, but we saw the firemen waving at us and doing sort of strange things with the hands, but we waved back. We didn't realise that they were telling us to get out of the way. And my husband then, he realised what was going on, so we beat a hasty retreat from the field.
And what effects were there afterwards?
We were all sick, even the dog, vomiting.
Did you have to have treatment?
I did, yes. I got dehydrated because I was vomiting such a lot, and I was in hospital for 24 hours.
All the crew suffered from dry throats, sore eyes, lethargy, diarrhea, and general discomfort. These symptoms lasted for 2 weeks. I think some were more affected than others. One of our crew, for instance, 2 days later collapsed at work and was readmitted to hospital.
The firemen were lucky. Their headquarters managed to establish that the chemicals they'd been sprayed with were a pesticide called Dursban and a fungicide called Baleton. And they also had access to this. Thank you, Louise. This is the printout of the hazards associated with those chemicals provided by the government's own official information service from Harwell. Neither Baleton nor Dursban is listed in Britain as highly poisonous to humans, though both can give off toxic vapour or fumes. But the American Environment Protection Agency requires Dursban to carry this warning: may be fatal if absorbed through skin or clothing. The spraying of the firemen of the Lee family wasn't an isolated incident.
Many school children each year are affected by pesticides. It causes them to stay away. It gives them flu type of symptoms. But in the longer term, those sort of nerve poison pesticides may cause depression, anxiety, and perhaps even forms of mental illness. And many of the pesticides are banned in other countries because they're thought to cause cancer or birth defects, and we just simply don't know how serious a problem that is here because the studies aren't being done.
All over the crop-growing areas of Britain, complaints about aerial spraying are heard, although there's evidence that only one incident in 100 is reported. Last year, over 150 separate incidents were officially recorded, often involving a number of people. For example, last summer, Alan Tipping, a smallholder in Lincolnshire, was motorcycling near his home when he ran into trouble.
I was just travelling down this road along here, and I noticed as I came just round the corner there that something was stinging my face and my lips. I couldn't actually, you know, see anything there, but something was stinging. I put my hand up to cover my face to protect me best I can, and I saw an aerial spray plane whose wing was literally travelling the other side of this hedge. And by the time I got to the other end of this little lane, I'd gone through it. I went home, cleaned up, phoned up the company who did the spraying. They were very evasive. They didn't want to tell me really what was going on. But eventually the second day, they said that I was sprayed with a substance called Zolon. The next day, I started to get some burns around the lips and across the forehead, the bits that I didn't have my hand covering.
It became clear quite quickly that he had been sprayed by an organophosphorus pesticide, which is one of the very few groups of pesticides which can be assessed chemically in the blood.
Like nerve gases, organophosphorus pesticides interfere with the human nervous system by destroying the body chemical which controls nerve impulses. Dr. Mansfield measured the level of this crucial chemical in Alan Tipping's blood.
And when we did it, we found that the level was quite low, and that would have been about 3 weeks after the actual incident. We were a little suspicious of this, so we actually arranged for two further tests to be done, and these were, because of natural delay, about 2 and 3 months afterwards. And these were 2.5 times higher than the original test 3 weeks after the accident. And the health and safety executive concluded in writing that these implied that in spite of the apparently short exposure, Alan had been affected seriously.
So what bodily functions are affected?
The temperature regulation would go wrong. Irritability, possibly to the point of convulsions, even changes of personality.
Now, how easy or how difficult is it to get something done when you suffer damage like this?
It's impossible. It's absolutely impossible. We tried every single organisation that could possibly do any help. starting at the police and working up. All of them are either totally hand-tied or it's not within their brief to do anything.
In desperation, you may appeal to your MP, who will no doubt do his best. But if you think the pilot of the aircraft was to blame and you want action taken against him, you'll have to get the Health and Safety Executive to persuade the Civil Aviation Authority to take him to court. The trouble is that in the last 2 years, 360 complaints have produced only 7 prosecutions and 2 convictions. In the end, you'll probably be left with the option of suing for damages for yourself. And as everyone knows, that can be costly, slow, and uncertain.
In the last 5 years, the quantity of agrochemicals used by farmers has nearly doubled to about 30,000 tons a year. Only 3% of this was sprayed from the air. Last year, the rules were tightened up to keep crop spraying aircraft more than 70 yards from houses. Contractors also have to give warning on the ground and in writing beforehand to people nearby. Both requirements hard to fulfill. But with so many difficulties, why is aerial spraying needed at all?
Because it fills a need which isn't met by other means of application. There are occasions when it's impossible to get onto a crop, and aerial spraying might well be the only way of saving that crop for the farmer.
Crop spraying per se is very inefficient. Less than 1% of the pesticide actually ends up anywhere near the pest. About 2/3 of it tends to go straight into the soil and may well contaminate water in an area like this. That presents a risk to wildlife and to people eventually. And about 1/3 of it tends to drift away as very small droplets, perhaps tens of miles, certainly hundreds of yards. And so it's an extremely inefficient, adolescent sort of industry, really.
Right, I'll just pick some of this for the chickens.
There is evidence that the children of farm workers and professional gardeners, all people regularly exposed to agrochemicals, suffer significantly more birth defects than the rest of the population. Alan Tipping and his wife have been sprayed from the air with a variety of agrochemicals more than once. Now expecting a family, they are naturally worried about the long-term effects.
There seems to be no one who will tell us for sure what exactly the long-term effects are going to be, and we want to be told.
Go on, let's do the rabbits.
Goodbye, then. Till next month.
In Dr. Mansfield's view, to allow manufacturers to test agrochemicals for safety, even under official supervision, leaves the short-term effects of chemicals on health unpublished and the long-term effects unknown. So this summer, he started his own survey of local people to assess the effects of aerial crop spraying on them.
By comparison with the drugs that we use, which I'm a bit more familiar with, it appears that there's no attempt made to assess the progress of a pesticide once it has been introduced into use. There are animal tests beforehand which may or may not be valid in themselves, but they cannot be regarded as the end of the story. It is necessary to continue afterwards, looking seriously to see whether any particular pesticide is producing effects on human beings which can be regarded as dangerous to their health. And that's done in the drugs, drug surveillance programs in this country, and in the end produced the kind of decisions like the abolition of thalidomide and so on. That is not done in relation to pesticides at all, as far as I can see, nor is there any immediate program for doing that.
I'm confident that the very great amount of work which is done by companies before they introduce a pesticide, before they seek clearance for its use, does cover, as far as it is possible to cover, the predictive necessity regarding long-term effects such as cancer.
Oh, the research is inadequate. It is very inadequate in this country compared to what's been going on in Germany and the United States and even in Soviet Russia, where so many of the chemicals that we're now using are now forbidden by law.
The Ministry of Agriculture and the manufacturers believe that the Food and Environment Protection Bill, now going through Parliament, will mean a higher standard of protection from harmful chemicals. But there will still be no specific laws to protect humans or wildlife, no specific prohibition on aerial spraying near footpaths or sites of special scientific interest. Richard Boddy.
Well, I think we've got to put a tremendous question mark over the whole thing, and on balance, I think it would be safer for the British people if we brought it to an end, because I don't think you could adequately control spraying from the air.
A complete and absolute ban?
I think we've come to that point.
That was a Conservative MP, Richard Boddy, report by Nicholas Woolley. Now, a progress report on some other watchdog stories in recent weeks as we take a second bite. 2 weeks ago on Watchdog, we showed how a Nissan dealer had gone bust and people who'd put deposits on Nissan cars had lost a lot. We found that other car companies, Ford and so on, help out their customers if a dealership goes down. Not so Nissan UK, even though in this case it was Nissan themselves who called in the receivers. But since our programme, Nissan have relented. On Friday, Beverly McLenahan took delivery of a Nissan Micra with a £500 discount to make up for what she'd lost when her first dealers went bust. Marjorie Castle got £5,000 off her new Nissan car. So, good for Nissan. What a pity it came so late that some customers have been left out in the cold, and what a pity they made what, being charitable, one must judge as a mistake. In a press statement last week, they accused the BBC of being irresponsible. They said that they had always intended to assist the victims of their dealer's bankruptcy. Oh, yes? Well, this is a letter to a customer dated the 30th of July, 12 days before our programme.
Dear sir, we are sorry you've been involved in the situation, but we regret there is nothing we can do.
5 days after Watchdog, that same customer was offered a discount of £500. An odd twist to another Watchdog story. Do you remember the multicoloured Barrett house built from two entirely different looking types of brick? Mrs. Marion Ritchie has spent about £1,000 on solicitors and surveyors fees trying to get Barrett's to put things right, but she hasn't made much impression, it seems. Barrett's have sent her this. It's a form asking her to nominate them as Builders of the Year. I wonder if she will. Since we launched our Watchdog declaration last week, we've been struggling to move in the Watchdog office. We've so far had 10,000 letters, rather more in fact, all asking for copies of the declaration and the action plan that tells you of your rights. So please do bear with us. We'll get them out to you just as fast as we can. Our report on sewage in the sea caused quite a stir. We've been asked, how do you tell if the beach is clean or if the water's full of you know what? Well, there is a simple test and you can do it all yourself. You'll need some scientific apparatus, though, to wit, a milk bottle. You fill it up with seawater and then you hold it up to the sun, though on this bank holiday weekend maybe you should take a torch with you. If the sediment settles quickly, then it's only sand and the sea is likely to be pure. But if the water stays cloudy after a couple of minutes, like this, then it's mixed with, well, if I were you, I'd go swim somewhere else. Now, if the thought of swimming in the sewage hasn't spoiled your tea, then what's coming next just might. I don't mean Lynn Folds Wood, of course, who's her normal delectable self, but this week she really has opened a can of worms, in more senses than one, and you've nice pair of gloves on,
I know. I'm wearing these because tonight's item is really horrible, and if you're eating your tea, you might like to look away. I'm talking about, oh, maggots. Oh, now, fishing's our most popular sport. Most fishermen use maggots, and lots of fishermen use these specially coloured maggots, which are quite horrible to touch, I can tell you, because it's said to attract the fish. But the bronze colour of these actually comes from mixing the maggots with a dye called chrysidine. Now, the dreadful thing is that we know that this dye can now be extremely dangerous. Take this family. Peter Birdsall and his sons Russell and Lee look like the perfect, happy fishing family. They aren't. Dad's got cancer.
The past 12 months I've known that I've been suffering from bladder cancer. And the first question I was asked was, had I had a job connected with dyes in any way, you know, where I've been working, and I hadn't, in no way. And then I knew that this chrysidine dye and bronze things were causing a lot of problems, and I happened to mention this to the doctors. They looked into it and they're almost 100% certain that it definitely was bronze. My son, for example, is 9 years old, and I wouldn't send him down the riverbank with a packet of 20 cigarettes to smoke one after another, which is virtually what you're doing, in my opinion anyway, if you buy them a pint of chrysidine maggots.
Now, this lady's Alice Smith. She's been an angler for 40 years, and it's really sad. She hasn't long to live.
I've got terminal cancer. My liver is badly affected now with secondary growth, and it's a chemical of some sort that's caused my cancer. The environmental health people have interviewed me, gone back through my working life, And the only thing that is they've come up with that I've been angling, the aniline dyes, mainly the chrysidine, because I've dyed my own maggots.
How do these dyes, Lynn, get from the maggots into people's bodies to cause the cancer?
Well, anglers sit there all day handling the stuff. It gets coated in their hands, onto their sandwiches and into their bodies that way. It seeps through the skin, through cuts in their fingers, but there's one really horrible way that it gets in there.
In the winter time, the fish is attracted to a moving bait. So in the winter time, what has happened? You've hooked your maggot onto your hook and just held it in the lips. Like that. Just to get that maggot wriggling. And I've done that many a time.
That's really repulsive, but that is tradition among anglers, but it is handling it without any gloves on that's the real problem.
Now, why are the maggots dyed this colour in the first place?
Well, they're dyed to make them, they think, to make them attractive to fish, to make them, to get a better catch. But the thing is that they didn't realise that this stuff was actually dangerous. This isn't meant for maggots. It's actually a dye that was developed for brown paper in the textile industry. And it became a craze in the 70s, though, to use it in maggots. And it was only when a rare form of cancer that you normally find only among old people, bladder cancer, started appearing in some young people, they looked at their lives and they found that one of the links was angling. And they now think there's a definite link between fishing, using dyed maggots like this, and a rare bladder cancer. But the peak of the deaths or the cases of this cancer appearing is not likely to happen until the 1990s. Now, one scientist done just finished a study in this, and his results are really alarming.
And over a period of 2 years now, we've been feeding and injecting mice with the chrysidine to see what the effects are, and the results look quite positive. In fact, we find that something like 65% of the treated mice develop over a two-year period different types of cancer. It should be banned. It should be just completely destroyed, taken up from the back parlours of shops where they're still selling it. The children are being exposed to this tremendous hazard, and I think a ban from government is the only thing that's going to make some people sit up and be frightened and hand in their supplies that they're keeping hidden.
Lynn, who is it who makes these dyes, and what do they say about this?
Well, there are several companies. The biggest of them is ICI. They probably supply most of this dye in Britain. And the thing is, they're absolutely appalled that their product may be being used to colour something like maggots for anglers. And they say that this is terrible, that anglers should not be touching chrysidine-dyed maggots with their hands. They would never allow their workers to touch them without gloves. And they say, in fact, that they know of no synthetic dyes used for maggots which are safe, and neither do the experts we've talked to. So anyone who's going fishing this weekend taking maggots, please take the white ones. Don't take the coloured ones till we do find a safe one.
Lynn, thank you very much. Now, last Thursday morning, a display was due to take place in the open air at Hendon Police College in North London. It was transferred indoors. Why? Well, because, we're told, watchdog cameras were waiting outside the gates. Why such sensitivity on the part of the police? Dina Gold reports.
My concern isn't whether my system is accepted or someone else's system is accepted, but that a system is accepted that will be safe for police women and effective, safe and effective for police women to use.
Tonight, Watchdog exclusively reveals the police's new martial arts weapon, which could be on the streets of London in the near future. This weapon is planned, initially at any rate, for use by police women. It's now 10:30 on Thursday, August the 22nd, and some very senior police officers are arriving at Hendon Police College in North London for a meeting which nobody wanted us to know about. They've come to see a demonstration of this, the new martial arts chain stick. We asked for permission to go in and film the display, but we were refused entry. For the last 6 years, the police have been fighting shy of any publicity to do with the introduction of martial arts into their tactics. In 1979, they first approached Mike Finn, who now runs his own martial arts academy in London. He's an ex-policeman of 7 years standing, who's gained 34 black belts in the martial arts and has trained with the Japanese riot police in Tokyo. His martial arts weapon was a simple wooden stick.
6 years ago, the police came to me and asked for my...